Hi everyone, my name is Philippe and I'm the CEO of CROWDSEC, and I'd like to explain to you today what the project is about. So, basically CROWDSEC works a bit like Waze somehow. You know, Waze uses your heading, your vehicle's heading, its speed and position to deduce whether there is a traffic jam ahead or a speed trap or something. So a community of users is sharing local information to deduce a global state, right? So what we're doing here is a bit different. We are using a local behavior by checking into the logs what's happening, you know, finding behavior in your logs and blocking if it's dangerous behavior. And when it's done, we share this information globally to the community so that it becomes a global reputation for the IP address behind the problem. A behavior engine is at the core of it. You can think about it like a modern version of fail-to-ban. So with the behavior engine, you can detect a lot of things like credential brute force. For example, if someone is trying to type in 5-time password and failed, maybe it's not his password and his account. It's just trying to guess your password. If usually your web shop is registering average cards of $30, but this time every credit card coming is doing like $0.1 transaction, maybe it's not a real customer. It's someone trying to validate credit card numbers. Same goes for post scan or web scan. If you have like a lot of 403, 404, or 50 something codes in your logs, probably someone is trying to scan you, right? So basically, CROWDSEC is filtering behaviors, not IP ports combos. It's really about like brute force, port scan, crawlers, exploits, SQL injection, and so on. And how does it do the magic? Well, it's a massively multiplayer firewall. You can think about it like a firewall because it's still filtering IPs at some point. But it's massively multiplayer because first it starts locally. It looks into your logs, so syslog, journald, AWS, CloudTrace, SIEM, ELKey, you name it. You know, it's just a data source. And then you apply scenarios. Could be your scenarios, could be our scenarios, or it could be community-driven and made scenarios. They are all available on the hub. And then once you found something with your scenario that is not appreciable, that you don't want, a behavior you don't want to see, you can, for example, drop it on your, say, on your reverse proxy, on your firewall, everywhere it makes sense. Or if you're working in an HTTP layer, you can send a captcha, for example. If you want to deal directly with the user session, you can forbid some access or some URLs, you can lower the rights, you can lower the speed, whatever. Or you can set a mobile factor authentication, whatever you want, actually. The remedy you want depends on your business and your stakes. If you want, you can just, you know, wire the information into a script or into your Slack channel with your DevOps or SecOps. So once you found a bad IP, you can share it with us, and we'll do the curation to be sure that it's an accurate signal and not a poisoning attempt or a false positive. And then we'll send it back to the community so that when you detect someone, everyone benefits from it and you benefit from everyone else's detection. That's how we make the wheel spin. This is a massively multiplayer firewall. So now, it's also a next-gen behavior engine. I told you before about fail-to-ban, but it's better and more modern than fail-to-ban in a way that it's stateless and decoupled. So you can detect in one point and remedy in another. You can also have like many-to-many setups, or one-to-many, or many-to-one setups. It's a high-performance engine. It's like 6 times faster because it's made in Go and not in Python. It provides observability right out of the box. You have a dashboard you can spawn and see what's inside, right? It's also modular and flexible, so it's super easy to embed into whatever DevOps system you're using to deploy things. It uses a very modern grammar, or very simple at least, which is YAML. So anyone can describe anything with a YAML file. It's super easy to edit and tweak according to your needs. It's adapted for Linux for now, but we are also porting the software on BSD, and we aim at being compatible with Windows as well. It's multi-layer, and you can deal with IPv6 as well. And you can do multi-stage detection, like if this and that, all that, then you know something else. What we're up to is a resource war. By banding together, we can burn the stolen IPs that hackers use to have anonymity, right? They use those IPs to shelter their activities, but they wouldn't be at ease with dealing directly with their own IPs straight to their target. So by burning those IPs, we are actually impairing and crippling their business. CrowdSec is basically peeling the onion. So the reputation engine is a second engine in CrowdSec. The first one is a behavior. The second one is based on all the sharing, all the sightings that we do all together. So far we know it's at the largest scale ever. It's the biggest honeypot on Earth, most likely. We are thousands of users and we aim at being hundreds of thousands, if not millions of users. It's highly curated. The list you receive of IPs you should ban is tailor-made for your needs, because we found out, looking in our data lake, that, for example, IPs doing SSH brute force are not the same as the one doing terminal server brute force or VPN brute force. So we want to provide you with the best tailor-made experience. And also, it's API first. So you can query the API in the way you want to integrate it at any place you want in your information system. Last but not least, you can have a hot query system or you can keep a local cache. We don't care much because the IP address is not of such a big value. The value lies in the network and its capability to generate the list. So if you have a local cache, it's no big deal. We are super fine with this, so you can update it like, you know, when you want. It's open source. It's for free. It's forever, period. We don't intend to switch this model later on when we'll be successful. Actually, the goal is to provide transparency so that anyone can see there's no shenanigans, no backdoor, no nothing in the code, that the code is clean and safe, that anyone can contribute to it, you know, help us connect more data source, create more scenarios, create more bouncers, and it helps us stay connected together. And somehow, it's a cross for cyber threat intelligence. Because, you know, what is CTI at its core? It's a bunch of servers, maybe 100 of them, running simulated services that we call honeypot on one or two clouds or three maybe to intercept traffic, rogue traffic over the internet. What we do is better in most directions because we harness the power of real machines by the thousand, by the hundred of thousand, running real services. So it's not simulated one because at some point hacker can pinpoint what is real and what is not. For example, if you have a web shop, the moment you put a credit card transaction, it's going to fail if it's a honeypot because you don't have a PSP behind. Or if you start to have like more interaction with a honeypot, you can spot that it's not a real machine. But here, it's not possible because it's real services. And it runs in all kinds of environments, everywhere, not only a couple of clouds. It could be like on a 5G connection, on a DSL or fiber, in a sweatshop in Thailand, university in Togo, in an individual place in Iceland or Finland. So it's impossible to dodge the people that are in the crowd of CrowdSec. That's why it's the best of a radar, hacker radar, we think. But now we have to deal with two threats, right? Poisoning and false positives. So we don't want people to be able to inject false IPs in the system. So we give them trust rank. You have a trust rank one if you're partaking into the network for more than 6 months and make constantly accurate spottings, right? So if you would start like 3,000 machine in an attempt to overrule the consensus, you would then reinforce us for 6 months before we start listening to you. And we'll see that if your cohort is then behaving in a way that it's the only one seeing things and not the rest of the network, it's probably that you're trying to poison us. Also, there are other trust rank, like 2, 3, 4, and so on. So if a trust rank 1 sees the same thing as a trust rank 2, it validates the signal. And the trust rank 2, 3, or 4 is getting a bit more credibility. That's cool. That's how they become trust rank 1 at some point. We also have a honeypot of our own. It's not made mostly for detection. It's mostly made to provide a counter opinion, a counter point of view on what is seen, for example, by a trust rank 2, but not by any other trust rank 1. Meaning, for example, it helps us to bootleg the network, to have a higher detection sensitivity on some technologies that, for example, our customers are not using yet. Say there is a vulnerability on WordPress or PrestaShop or Hybris, and we don't have yet enough users on those technologies, then we can spoon a bunch of Hybris or PrestaShops to simulate and listen, you know, and validate signals. So we are trust rank 0. We are validating other signals as well. We also have a list of canaries. This list is something that you cannot ban. So you will find here things like Microsoft Update, Googlebot, and so on. IPs that are already core to internet gearing, and we don't want to ban them at any point in time. So it's kind of a whitelist, if you want. And we have predictive algorithms. Like if IPs A, B, C, and D are working together, we are just below the minimum threshold of noise that we would consider as being aggressive, then those IPs would then go through, you know? Except if a predictive algorithm is digging into our honeypot log in our global data lake and try to correlate that IP A, B, C, and D, IP A, B, C, and D are working together. So that way we can also prevent them from harming you. And once it's done, this curation process, the IP is integrated in the IP rotation database and distributed throughout the network. You have to know that a bad IP is a time-dependent thing, right? It used to be a good IP. It has been compromised and is now acting maliciously most of the time. Some of them are constantly malevolent, but most of them are just on a temporary basis compromised. So it's rogue, and then it will be cleaned one day by its legitimate owner. So that's why our network density allows us to clean every IP that have not been caught doing dangerous things for the last 72 hours. It's kind of a self-cleanup thing, right? And if this IP waits 73 hours and come back, then it would be instantly reinstated in the consensus. And it's extremely important because IPv4 shortage triggered a lot of NAT IPs, NAT meaning network address translation. So one public IP can shelter a lot of people. So we advise you to only take the minimum necessary remediation. So for example, if you are working on an HTTP layer, for example, send a CAPTCHA. Don't drop the connection, because you could drop the connection for many legitimate users that are behind a proxy, for example. Whereas if you send a CAPTCHA, you will just slow down tremendously a potential attacker, but not detail legitimate users. The next thing is, we have a 3-day probing mechanism I told you about, like the 72 hours. You can also self-deban yourself. It's not so easy for hackers because they would not be able to deban all the IPs they're using. And also there's a CAPTCHA here, so you're not supposed to be able to deban like tons of IPs. And there's an increasing penalty. So if your IP is debanned by you and it's caught again and again and again, there's an increasing time penalty before you can deban yourself again. Also, the consensus is involving range qualification. For example, some IPs are used by 4G networks. We don't want to ban them because we don't know who's the user behind, right? So it's changing constantly, so it doesn't make sense to ban them, for example. Or sometimes protocols like UDP are really easy to fake, to spoof, so it's complicated to ban UDP-based attacks. And also, we send you a tailor-made list just for your needs. We don't want like to broadcast every IPs everywhere because that would create more harms than good. You have to know that your logs are never ever exported. They stay locally. We don't treat them, we're not a SIEM, we're not storing them. We parse them, we learn from them, and we forget them. So they don't go into the cloud. We just use the timestamp, the offending IP, and the behavior. This is the only thing we collect. And if you don't want it, you can disable this feature, right? So you don't have even to share with us. And then you just benefit from the behavior engine, not the reputation one, obviously. But nevertheless, you get a great reputation behavior engine. And also, it's GDPR compliant because we are collecting the minimum necessary information to do our work. And you have no online dependency. You also have our word that we only monetize things that are like for business grade enterprises, like fleet features, deploying on thousands of machines, self-monitoring and forensic, API access on a massive scale and so on. So it's always free for the community. But if people are not sharing with us and want to benefit from the behavior, from the reputation engine, then they would have to pay their access for it, right? Or if they want like extended features that are mainly for big businesses. That's what we do, and I'm glad I could tell you about this. If you have any question, don't hesitate to go on our Gitter, on Discourse, or find us on GitHub. We are CROWDSEC, and I'm glad you spend time with us. Have a good day. Bye.